It's Matt from the rooftop, back in Spain. Up on the roof, enjoying a nice cup of coffee. Wake me up a bit. I'm a bit knackered today. So what's it like being back in Spain? Well, the first thing is getting the run from Birmingham was a bit of a pain in the backside. Got to Birmingham Airport and they've shut their overflow car park. So it was easier to wait in the traffic about half hour. Then got my brother to drop me off at the train station, and then I got like the little monorail thing, which is in the other video, to go to the station. And then we got there, waited for the plane, got on the plane, wait until you all sit down, everyone's happy. Then the old pilot comes on and goes, been waiting an hour for Esso to refuel the plane. They haven't arrived yet. We're going to be at least another 20 minutes. So then we had to wait for Shell Oil. Shell Oil come and did it instead. Arrived a little bit later in Spain. But the video before this one, you'll see I was quite happy to get out of the airport, into the van and gone. So it's good. Good to be back. Does it feel like home? Yes, it does. It really does. Obviously, my wife and kids are here. As soon as I got in the van, got the engine running, the first thing I'm thinking of is getting home before the kids go to bed so I could see them, tomorrow, last night. So they were all excited when I turned up, unexpected, rifling through my bags shortly afterwards, searching for presents. Woken up at 5 a.m. this morning with Zoe coming to wake us up, because obviously she's still excited to see me, so I've been up since 5 o'clock. Went and did the ITV, which is the roadworthiness test here in Spain, same as the UK MOT. Van went through again. I'll tell you now, there's no way that would work in the UK, and I'm glad that Spain's not a nanny state, that's all I can say, because the vehicle's sound. There's no issues with it. I mean, if anything, it's probably more mechanical than anything else, but certainly not from a safety point of view. So I was really happy that went through this morning. Took April out for lunch, did a bit of shopping, picked the kids up from school. Tomorrow, go and pick up the residency cards. And next on the list is April's driving. She's already started doing some revision for the written test here, because it's like the UK, you have to do a written test before you can drive on the roads. So she's already started revising for that. She's also been using YouTube to get an idea of how a car works, you know, gears, that sort of stuff. So yeah, that's good. I'm looking forward to April passing the test and getting her a little run around for here in Spain, and I can see her whizzing off to Cartagena and other places once that happens. Everything's good, everything's on the up. My contract work-wise, I'm nearly out my first month, but another 2 months to go, so financially my car parking is paid up at Alicante Airport now for the next 12 months. Next 3 weeks I'm going to buy a car in the UK, so I'll be mobile there and leave a car there. The car here, obviously, the van here has just gone through its ITV, so that's good for another 6 months. See how April gets on with her driving, because when she passes the test, I'll buy a little car for whizzing around here, but also it means we can get something a bit more reliable to go a bit further afield. That's one thing about Spain, it is a big place, so travelling around, do need something a bit more reliable than my T4 that I seem to spend a lot of time underneath repairing. But I knew that when we got it, it would be a work in progress, but it will get replaced probably sooner rather than later. But I'll get April a car first, and like I said to April, if the car insurance goes down on the van this year, I might just keep it for running backwards and forwards to the airport for now, and get something more reliable later. Because if April gets a car, and then I upgrade the van or just keep the van for just running around, that's fine. So everything's good. One of the things we are looking at, though, is getting a bigger place. We've got the two-bed at the minute. Kids are getting to that age where they need their own space. Since I've been away, he's started sleeping in the sitting room because he finds it nice and quiet there compared to dealing with Zoe singing and stuff when he's trying to sleep. So I think I'm getting pushed to decision time on getting a place sorted out for at least an extra bedroom. Yeah. I begrudge renting a place because the extra bedroom, rent-wise, it probably cost me an extra half the rent, if you know what I mean. I'm not paying... It works out per bedroom. It's going to cost me the same on the another half the rent to get that extra bedroom or a bit more. But also here, there isn't many houses, so you're going to be looking at a three-bedroom apartment. So I'm still thinking about that, because I don't really want to move out of Limata. I could go up the other end of town, I suppose, but we like where we are, so it's... I don't know. I don't know what to do with that at the minute. We do want to buy later, but buying, like I've mentioned before, it's going to cost about 45,000 euros deposit. So I'm not in a rush to do that right now. Got the Brexit on the doorstep, got the whole setup thing now going forward long term. So we're getting April through a driving test, sorting some work out, etc., is the priority, because obviously we can stay as we are for at least the next 6 months without any hassles. But I do want a bigger place. But like I said, I don't know where we'll go. I mean, these places are quite nice. Opposite, I don't want to drop my coffee over the balcony, so I let go. They've got a large balcony area. They're 3-4 bedroom, but the prices shoot up here significantly. As soon as you get over 2 bed, prices like increase a lot. But even, I mean, that's a 3 bedroom there on the left here, just below that one with the sign on it. They're coming in at over 100,000 euros. I can't really justify that on that. I know on the property, the construction method that it's got. But also, when you look at some of the 2 beds and stuff, they're way cheaper. Probably work out just as cheap to buy 2 beds. And then just in the holiday season, where I'm likely to be working, everyone squeezes into the one, rent the other one out, and that'll pay the mortgage for the year on the other one. Because the rents here can be ridiculous, because obviously being a tourist spot, you pay a premium for that. And I'm not knocking it, because in all honesty, I may do the same. If I own a property here and could get 500 euros a week or 400 euros a week instead of 300-400 a month, I might do it. And the reason I say might is because I've had a good long-term tenant like myself, then having somebody that lives there for 4 years and pays 300 a month, no aggravation, don't have to bother with the place at all, that's an even better deal. But I do know a lot of people see the 2-3 months of the year as the main goal of getting money in those months, and the rest of the year they just leave it empty or just use it as and when for themselves. Hence, it's difficult to find a long-term rental in Limata. It does take a bit of time and a bit of hunting around, a bit of asking around as well, because a lot of them aren't advertised. Going with a real estate agent, you're probably adding at least 50 euros to the rent a month anyway for their management fee, although I'm not sure what many manage, because on a monthly basis there isn't a lot to do, is there? To be fair, unless you're actually going there and doing the routine inspections and stuff, you're not exactly working for it. But hey ho, that's just one of those things. But beyond that, everything's good. Work's okay, work's getting there. If anything, I'm sort of seeing I need to invest a bit more time in my training. I've got a load of training material myself. I've got several books I need to read, but that'll come when I've got time to do it. The other side of this being, my mother's been quite ill as well lately, so back in the UK next week, so hoping she's feeling a bit better by the time I get back. But yeah, it's beyond my mother being pretty bad, everything else is going quite well. But yeah, the only problem I get with it coming back here, I start thinking about should I go back to the UK or not. Because as soon as you start coming into this, in the UK, I've been dealing with rain most days. Walked home in the rain a few days when I ain't be able to organise a lift. Why don't I get a taxi? I begrudge paying the taxi. It's just myself. I don't use taxis. Don't use bus. I only use a train because it's convenient. But generally, I don't use public transport. I'd rather walk. I've always been like that, even when I was a kid. I used to get lunch money when I was a kid in bus fare. I used to spend the lunch money in my bus fare on computer magazines and just walk the distance instead, which my old school was an hour and a half's walk. But you don't mind. We've got something to read. But yeah, so yeah, I'm not a fan of that. I don't mind walking, but I'm just not a fan of public transport. Just never have been. Philippines is fun. But yeah, I'm not a big fan of it in general. I can understand why people use it. It's just I'm not a fan of it. There was a funny conversation the other day on the train. This woman was from the NHS in some form. I'm not sure what she was doing, but she was talking to somebody else and seemed a bit feminist in her viewpoints. But she's nattering on this woman how useless her son-in-laws are. So, it's got two son-in-laws, blah, blah, blah. Really loud. So, it's like 8:30 in the morning. Everyone's like busy doing their stuff on the train. This woman's nattering on. I said, they're really useless around the house. Can't do anything. The daughters do the gardening, anything that needs done in the home. They would rather just pay for people to do it than do it themselves. And the woman she was talking to said, well, what did they do? Well, one of them's a senior psychologist and the other one's a surgeon. And I'm thinking, yeah, that's what you want. A surgeon to smack his hand with a hammer, putting a door up or a shelf up, rather than keeping his hands for what they're designed for and used for and what their skill is, which is surgery. It's pretty obvious why they get other people to do their stuff. They can afford the luxury, but also it's time. You know, it's time, and everyone knows their forte in life. You know, at the end of the day, everyone's good at something. It doesn't mean you have to be good at everything. I think that's one of the problems in this world today. Everyone's supposed to be good at everything. Like me, one of my problems I know is I'm often too blunt. I also know that I don't take waffle lightly, in the sense that some of the training courses I've had to do, I've actually said to the lecturers, this is absolute rubbish. Why waffling on about this, that and the other when one word will do? Just get to the bloody point. And I think that's probably two of my main ones for me. Skill-wise, I'm not a great painter. At the end of the day, everybody's not good at everything. Everyone should understand their limitations and not being good at something. So what? At the end of the day, we're all good at something. And we all have something we enjoy doing or whatever, even if we're crap at it. It's like football. I like playing football, but I know I'm not a good footballer, That's it. You do stuff to enjoy life. I don't understand why there's so much negativity these days. I find the media is a lot to blame, and I do think a lot of people need to unplug themselves sometime. Like me, how much TV have I watched? Nothing. I'm sat up here drinking a coffee on the roof talking to you guys, watching a couple over there that's watching me on their balcony. They're overlooking the sea. Looking at me, wondering what that guy's doing on the roof, talking to his phone. But yeah, there's more to life. Just chilling out and relaxing. I know we'll get where we want to be. It's going to take a little bit of time. Hopefully I can get my mother-in-law over to Spain soon as well. We've got her passport stuff being processed at the minute. Although there's some issues with the passports relating to one of the big problems. This is something I should bring up actually. It's very common for people to have the same name as somebody that's on a watch list. It's probably my mother-in-law's already had her sorted out, but it's probably about the seventh person I know that have had problems getting their passport and stuff because they've got the same name as somebody on a watch list. They just need to confirm that it's not you, and then they're fine with it. I mean, I'm thinking, I don't know what it seems such a strange system where it can take months to get this confirmation, but that's the way it is. But also, there's an issue with the birth certificate. Now, bearing in mind, my mother-in-law is not a teenager, so getting it corrected is a major task. Because it's relating to, it's complicated, let's just say that. So we're just hoping her passport goes through okay without any complications, because sorting that could take another year. Yes, I said a year, because there's a name wrong on one of the birth certificates. That could take a year to sort out. So I'm hoping that gets resolved. So we'll see how that goes. And then after that, we'll get all the embassy stuff so she can come out here on holiday and see somewhere that isn't the Philippines for a change. A new country. And once she's done that, I think I've got a bit of a surprise for her coming up. Not this year, but I'm not going to mention it for now. But I've got something that I know she'll really love. And I'll keep that under my hat for now. But I'll take her on another holiday that I know she would love later on. So once my mother-in-law's been out here, I think that'll be here on a regular basis, probably come out a couple of times a year. We'll hop back to the Philippines as and when, and all things good. In conversations with a few people relating to the call centre stuff in the Philippines now as well, because we've had a couple of ideas, and I think we're just going to have to start moving things along a little bit. I've also got all my apartments available as well, because one of my tenants moved out, I think a week or so ago. He'd been there for a year or so. Yeah, probably about a year or so. And the month before, the other tenant, her sister had finished building her house, so she'd gone. She'd been another long-term resident. And we've got our Portuguese friend over at the moment. He's going in a couple of weeks, because he comes and goes every year. I've got four apartments available at the minute. I do get people ask me why I don't invest too much in the refurbishment and putting all the furniture and that in here. But here's a bit of advice, explains why I do it. When people move to the Philippines, you often want to upgrade and change things anyway. So what I do is I can simply move all the furniture. So if you decided, you go in there, it's furnished, and then you say, Matt, can I bring my own bed? Can I bring my own furniture? And you want to buy your own stuff, that's fine. The reason I don't invest too much on things is I probably had 7 TVs break. One of the tenants recently left me with a broken aircon. Didn't bother mentioning anything. So that's another 13,000 pesos that's going to go in there. But ultimately, a lot of people want their own little mark. So we just basically furnish them. And if you turn around and says, can I get myself a sofa and you move that one? The answer is yes. We've got loads of storage space. The idea being is you make it your own space. You know, at the end of the day, they're for sort of transition periods. You move to the Philippines, not sure where you want to live. You can live in our place. We've got CCTV. It's secure, it's safe. So if you said, Matt, I'm off to Luzon for a month, you know your stuff's still going to be there when you get back. That's the reasons that they are what they are. But you go to Luzon, meet the love of your life and decide to move up there, that's sort of normal. A lot of people just use them for the first 3 months or whatever, just to get a feel for the area. Well, I've had a few people live there long term. and no issue with it. And like I say, if you want to upgrade stuff, change things, I don't care. I really don't. It's your space. Just let us know and we'll move the furniture, whatever, elsewhere. We put the rents up as well, because we're doing them at 6K, they're now 8K plus the bills, because we haven't put the rent up in a long time. But also, due to the breakages recently, we're going to change some of the stuff. But yeah, I mean, they're good little one-bedroom places. I don't think they'll be empty long. I did have somebody ask me a couple of weeks back, and they were all full at that time. But now we've had a few people move out, I might give them a call back. But one of the things I will say, the internet's free there as well. And the reason I say it's free is it's not in the rent. And I stress that because if you know the Philippines internet, you cannot guarantee it's always working. As such, it's free. So if it's broke, it's broke. If it's working, it's working. It's as simple as that. We're looking at opening the call center very soon as well. So there may be some flexibility when the call center is not in use to use our high-speed internet. But that's what I'll call a luxury. That's up to me. I'm not putting that in anybody's rent because I may need the internet myself, so that we'll wait and see on that. But yeah, there is free internet. I think it's 5 meg or whatever. Yeah. But anyway, I've nattered on long enough. That's 20 odd minutes. So enjoy your day. Have a good evening, good afternoon, good morning, and hi from Spain.